You know, it's the most significant biblical find in a modern era. Mm-hmm. And nobody knows about it.
There's a mystery being revealed today. Yet forces stand against its discovery. Why would they try to hide new evidence of the Exodus? For over 20 years, these explorers have risked their lives to uncover the mystery of the Exodus.
Across the valley floor from the base of Mount Sinai lie the remarkably preserved remains of the altar to the golden calf. Once again, I was miraculously able to slip inside the fence undetected and record the images of cattle literally covering these rocks. These petroglyphs, or rock carvings, represent distinctly Egyptian gods, with Hathor being the female representation and Apis the male. These gods were actively worshipped in Egypt during the time that the Israelites were held captive there. The story is relayed to us in the 32nd chapter of Exodus, where the people grew restless waiting for Moses to return from the top of Mount Sinai. The people told Aaron, "Up, make us gods to go before us." Aaron took their gold and fashioned for them a molten calf with a graving tool. What is intriguing about the story is that he fashioned a single idol, yet said, in sight of all of Israel, "These be thy gods, O Israel, which brought thee up out of the land of Egypt." The scripture makes the same point later in the chapter, when Aaron is explaining to what happened to Moses. He claims the people wanted gods to come before them, so he took their gold out, and out came a calf, once again singular. Looking at this site, however, the scripture becomes beautifully clear. Aaron prepared an altar to the idol, and then set the calf on the very top. The cattle you see here were carved right into the rocks upon which it sat. Standing back from the spectacle, one would have seen a golden calf sitting atop the rock carvings of Apis and Hathor, their former Egyptian gods. The calf, along with the images beneath it, would have been correctly spoken of as plural. "These be thy gods, O Israel." It is noteworthy to mention that cattle have never been native to Saudi Arabia. These Egyptian gods, carved in stone, found here near the foot of the mountain, surely give us yet another piece of evidence proving the certain truth of the Word of God.
There's quite an abundance of evidence. Not only now do we have the mountain sitting there that's got a cave on it, that's got a brook descending out of it, there's a very unique stone formation. There's pillars and foundation stones, and all of these things are spoken of directly in the scripture. Now, out in the valley where the people would have been, there's a fenced off area with a bunch of cattle carved on the rock. Wow.
Let's look at 41. Again, we're just talking about these comparisons. Mm-hmm. You can see a photo down in the left
and
showing the style of horns. And then the next slide, which is the apis.
So you can see
the connection to this.
Just how similar they are.
And then the last slide just gives you 43, gives you the grave area.
Wow.
And its location out of the camp, the golden calf altar. And then all right, that's good.
Oh, my goodness.
Well, we're going to be in for a real thrill, Tommy, when we come back from this short break. And I know you won't want to tune out.
For sure.
And you'll probably be wanting to get a copy of the DVD as well as her book.
And the book.
And the book.
We'll be telling you more about the book when we come back. And, oh, my goodness, thank you.
I've got a big question when we come back.
Excellent.
So,
thank
stay
you for
tuned.
Sharing this awesome story.
If you enjoyed this program, GLC asks that you would help support us in the production of these programs. You can make your contribution through our website at www.glc.us.com. by phone 432-563-5200 or 1-866-846-5200 or by mail at P.O. Box 61000, Midland, Texas 79711-1000. We would like to extend our thanks for your prayers and support.
Just east of Mount Horeb and well north of the base of Mount Sinai, a massive graveyard lies undisturbed behind another archaeological fence the Saudis have erected. In this never-before-released footage, you can clearly see the ancient headstones dispersed throughout the area. My dad and I secretly slipped inside this fence to obtain proof on film of this remarkable sight. We know, according to Exodus 32:28, that at least 3,000 men died after worshiping the golden calf, and by Levitical law, would have to be buried outside the main camp. Back to the valley, a small white building is surrounded by a rectangular fence. We believe this was built over the ruins of the original tabernacle. Oddly enough, in a high plain between Horeb and Sinai, another rectangular set of stone ruins has been left alone. Moses moved the tabernacle away from the main camp after the golden calf incident. Evidence of this is plainly found here. On their way up into this high pasture, Mom and Dad found another surprise waiting for them. Amazing because of its rarity, an enormous cedar appears out of nowhere, with two others that are actually attached by root systems to this one. As you can see from the sparse landscape with Mount Sinai in the background, there are no others on any of these mountains. Cedars do not grow in this area at all. Why was this one here? Upon closer inspection, the trunk of this cedar is more than 8 feet thick. Smaller olive trees in Israel have been found to be over 2,000 years old. Moses was tending the flocks of Jethro when he turned aside to see the burning bush, and God spoke to him directly. Could this be that very plant? My sister Chelsea and I were also with my parents when we located the almond trees. These are important to find on the mountain because Aaron's rod was made from an almond tree and budded and produced ripe almonds according to number 17:8. The bowls of the golden candlestick were also fashioned after the almond tree. Just as an interesting note, Horeb and Sinai are also covered with fig trees. Though a subject of much debate, the nation of Israel has many times been referred to as the fig tree in prophecy. They are to be found only on these two mountains. Finally, quail can be seen all over the area to this day. It is theorized that they fly in huge numbers over the sea from Egypt, only to fall to the ground exhausted on the Arabian side. Exodus 16:13 reads, "And it came to pass at evening, the quails came up and covered the camp."
Possibly the greatest witness giving validity to Mount Sinai being in Arabia is the rock at Horeb. This enormous rock is split cleanly down the middle and is completely different from anything else in the region. It stands high atop one of the boulder hills that dot the landscape and on the west side of Horeb, not Sinai. The Bible identifies it exactly this way. I'm standing on the back side of the rock here, and it's easy to see just how large it really is. As I began my walk between the two giant slabs of rock, I became acutely aware that something entirely miraculous had taken place here long ago. Making my way right through the middle of the split, scriptures started rolling over and over again in my head. They became alive to me as I made it through and sat down on the front side. I began to notice immediately the deep channels that were cut into the stone both in front and the back of this rock. You can see one of these channels clearly here. Deep gouges and grooves are apparent at the base also, along with a strange erosion pattern from below that is unique to this rock and no others in the valley. With rainfall every 10 years amounting to less than an inch here, these very obvious cuts made by copious water flows were indeed compelling. Again, the channels are obvious. As we followed the course of the water all the way down and into the valley, we realized the immediate area under the rock was of a smooth and unbroken granite, unlike the crushed particles of stone we'd been hiking on all over the rest of the region. If this rock was the one Moses struck, the waters would have cooled up substantially and the whole of Israel, including their flocks, could have taken their fill and been satisfied. In addition, a stone altar lies at the ground base of this rock. The Amalek came to fight Israel there at Rephidim, where the rock was, And after the battle, Moses built an altar and called it Jehovah Nissi. This giant stone has a circular pit we believe was formed by cumulative fires. Clean through this rock at the ground level below, evidence of ash can be seen. Psalm 78, 15 and 16 says, He clave the rocks in the wilderness and gave them drink as out of the great depths. He brought streams also out of the rock and caused the waters to run down like rivers.
Here you can see just how it stands out in the landscape.
My.
In fact, I put the we made the cover of my book this because it's very, very specific. You know, in my little Sunday school mind, I guess, I had pictured that Moses tapped a little rock and everybody stood in line with their little cup. No, you got to think way bigger than that. They've been 3 days in the wilderness. You can, that's actually Dr. Leonard Moeller right there. In the trip we made in 2003, you can see he's halfway up the rock there.
Uh-huh.
You see how big it is. Everything that we have found in this landscape is far bigger than we could have ever imagined. But what happened is this is an enormous rock, and the miracle that must have taken place there when Moses struck that rock the first time,